Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's weekly worship podcast. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following sermon, titled On the Road to Emmaus, was recorded on Sunday, April 30th, 2017, at our 9 o'clock service, and was delivered by Pastor Edgar Schambach. The gospel reading was from Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 through 25. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now on that same day, meaning that first Easter, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. And while they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning. When they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it's almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." And then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The road to Emmaus is one of the great, great Bible stories. Luke tells it well. He tells it well. He has a way of bringing this story to life. He does it so well that it's even more than a story. It has become a metaphor in Christian faith for many different things about our journey in faith. The way he lays it out in stages, kind of like that illustration on the bulletin cover, the stages of the story, helping us to find in some way our own experiences in the journey of faith. The two disciples on the way home, a very despairing journey home. They are devastated by grief, They have lost Jesus. They witness something horrifying in his crucifixion. They are so devastated, they do not recognize Jesus. He is a stranger on the road. They can barely share with him the news of what had happened. On the road, Jesus opens to them the scriptures. And he begins to lead them into a deeper understanding of God's word. And by that I mean God's way of love and salvation, leading them deeper into the word deeper in their heart, that it might come alive in a new way, as we see later in the story. And just as Jesus opened the scriptures to them, they opened their home to Jesus. They arrive at Emmaus, and they have this beautiful invitation. It's part of our evening prayer liturgies. Stay with us. It is evening, and the day is now over. And then comes the great surprise. The disciples who are serving as hosts to Jesus, inviting him to their table, they now become guests, and he is the host in the breaking of bread. And in that moment, their eyes are opened. They see the Lord. How long that moment lasted, I cannot say. And when the moment was over, their hearts, they realized something has changed, transformed. They have been made whole in a new way, that burden lifted from them. Their eyes now see. Did not our hearts burn within us? And then the journey back, a rushed journey back, this time with the joy of news, we have seen the Lord. The road to Emmaus. It is a great story, and as I say, it is also a powerful metaphor for the so many things in spiritual life. It is a metaphor of worship with that gathering, the opening of the scriptures, the breaking of the bread and the meal, and then the sending, the going back to tell the good news. It is a metaphor, the road to Emmaus, a metaphor for the whole of our journey of faith. It is a metaphor for different aspects and stages in our journey of faith as we mature. It is a metaphor for the journey of grief. Indeed, that is how this story begins. Two disciples deep in grief. This morning, I'd like to talk to you particularly about that journey of grief. Friday, 13 years ago, Friday marked the death of our daughter, Angie, and I'd like to talk about that in a way, not for sympathy purposes, but because I believe it is important for us to share our stories of grief. Often we keep those stories to ourselves. I look out on a congregation, and I see many faces who have lost loved ones. Some of you have lost children. Some of you have lost grandchildren, spouses, parents, dear friends. Someone shares with me, even as I prepare to come into worship, a deep sadness of losing so many friends just in the last few months, and now again another funeral. It's important to understand these experiences and the fullness of our faith in the light of this journey to Emmaus. And so let us talk in this fashion. I say that the story of the road to Emmaus is a metaphor, and approaching it as metaphor allows me to take maybe a little more liberty with how we might teach the story. For example, two disciples make their journey home to Emmaus. One of them is named, the other is unnamed. I don't know if that was Luke's intention to leave one unnamed, but I'm glad he did, because it allows me to read my name into that story. And that allows you to read your name into that story. two disciples journeyed to Emmaus. One of them is Cleopas, and the other is, well, Edgar, or your own names. We are on this journey to Emmaus. One of them is named, his name, Cleopas. And I am glad one of them is named. It is important that we take this journey together. In the journey of grief, very, very lonely to take it all by oneself. It is important to remember we are the body of Christ, sharing the joys, sharing the sorrows together. Cleopas, he reaches across the generations, the many years. He walks with us, as do all the other saints who have gone before us, even our loved ones, in a great mystery, the communion of saints, walking this road. Jesus in the center. Cleopas walking with us, brothers and sisters together walking. We walk this journey of grief, not alone. Not alone. Now, Luke has this curious way of speaking. He says, Emmaus, it was about 7 miles from Jerusalem. Not 6. Not 8. 7. In the spirit of metaphor, I see that as a holy number. 7 in scriptures is a sacred number, a number meaning whole and complete. In the journey of grief, often we think of it as fragmentary, of something that's ugly and disruptive, of something we just want to shove aside if there were a way to do that. And yet, because this journey is in Christ, and that we are not alone, it is whole and complete. Arriving at Emmaus, whole and complete, beautiful things finally come to this story. And in our own journeys of grief, that is the promise. Not fragmentation, not dead ends, but something that is whole and complete. Now on this journey, Jesus shared with them, he opened the scriptures to them, and he begins in that kind of rough way, and he says, Oh, foolish ones, slow to get it. I don't take that as a slap in the face. I suppose I could. But I see Jesus just saying, I want to lead you to a deeper place in the Word, not at the foolish level of platitudes and sayings from Scripture. And often in the time of death, we are filled with those platitudes. And people mean well by them, I know. But they don't go deep, do they? Jesus wants to plant a word deep. He says, here, let me open God's living word to you. Let me speak the words of God that are true consolation, comfort, and peace. Let me help you understand the Via Dolorosa, the way of suffering and pain and loss. I have walked that road, but it leads to life. It leads to a fullness of the love of God, indeed to know the love of God in its fullest depth. One must walk this road, and I walk it with you. So he opens the scriptures to them in this deeper way. And it's a beautiful moment in the home when they welcome him to his table, and he breaks bread, and he gives his presence to them. Their eyes are opened. And then they say, after the moment is gone, they say, something happened on that road. Something's happened here at the table. Did not our hearts burn within us? And it's more than an emotion that they are speaking of. They are speaking of this ordeal of grief that has been touched with the fire of the Holy Spirit. The fire of a presence of God that brings consolation, brings life, the gift of Christ to them. The scriptures speak of that fire as a purifying fire. something that brings a truer faith to our soul, makes us more who we are, even if the journey is hard. Makes us more of who we are in God as His children. And we come to know that more deeply. Purifying fire. Two of the Beatitudes speak to this. The first, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And we're not talking tissue kind of comfort, just wiping tears away. We're talking about the deep comfort that we see as in this story. Comforted with the presence of God that is transforming. And a second beatitude, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. We've seen the Lord, they say. Did not our hearts burn within us? We have seen the Lord, a purifying fire. Blessed are the pure, those who have been purified in this way, for they shall see God. When we lost our daughter, Angie, 13 years ago, tomorrow, May 1st, is the day we buried her. That was devastating, of course, you know that. And some weeks later, I sought to put my experiences as best I could into some way of understanding what had happened in our life. And I want to share with you what I wrote. I called it The Unwelcome Border. And I wrote this some weeks after Angie was buried. And then a couple of years later, when I shared it in a public gathering, I added a postscript. And I'll share with you the postscript. And sharing it with you again today, I have to add a postscript. And I share this, especially for those of you who have experienced deep, deep loss, that you might understand some of your own experience as well and realize you are not as alone in your feelings and experiences as you may think. The Unwelcome Border, written sometime in late May 2004. And when our daughter Angie died on April 28th, suddenly Betty and I were plunged into a world of grief we had visited only briefly. Even though Angie had been diagnosed with advanced lung cancer in early January, and we knew the gravity of her disease, those 4 months did little to prepare us for her loss. On April 28th, our lives were changed. We lost a daughter we dearly loved, and we gained an unwelcome border in our life named grief. He now lives with us, even though we did not invite him, and we wish he would leave. Sometimes we leave our unwelcome border behind when we go out and are about our business, but he's always there waiting for us when we return home. Sometimes he annoyingly tags along, even though we wish he would stay behind. As far as borders go, he is unbearable. His character is distasteful. Sometimes we associate the experience of grief with the outward emotions of tears and anguish. And while tears are a part of grief, an intense part to be sure, they are actually only a small part of the experience. We shed our tears, wipe our eyes, blow our noses, take a deep breath, but then we go on. However, so much of grief is simply a great weight of emptiness. Who would have thought emptiness could be so heavy and hurt so? Life becomes hollow for a passage of time yet to be measured. No sooner did our border grief move in, when at once he began to rearrange our household to his way of thinking. Over the many years of family life, we had developed all the comforts of home, the habits, the rituals, the holidays together, the cheery-voiced phone calls. However, grief moved in and rearranged all of it. He acts as if our home is his. What a pain he is. What a heartfelt pain. In time, this will change. A day will come when we will wake up and go forth to meet the new day. And when we come home, we will discover that he has moved out. On that day, we will know that the promises of our Lord are right. Joy is greater than sorrow. Love is greater than loss. Hope is stronger than death. Some months after writing that, a dear friend, and I would say an angel, God-sent friend, named Annette Kruger in my church. She was a social worker, and she worked at the hospital and home health care hospice. And she would lead, from time to time, classes in a grief support group. And some months after Angie's passing, we joined the grief support group. And Annette had invited us to share in some way our experience, either with music or something we had written or photographed, whatever it might be. And I shared in one of our sessions the border. And after it, she took me aside and she said, Pastor, thank you for sharing. There will come a day when you will make friends with your border. And I said to myself, no way. It really angered me that she said it almost, you know. No, I want him out. She said, you will make friends with your border. And while I did not fully understand those words, I knew they had some wisdom behind them. And so I have remembered them to this day. Well, the postscript, written December 9th, 2006, 2.5 years later. The postscript, I was invited to share the unwelcome border at a gathering at our church for our community. It was the Worldwide Remembrance Service by Compassionate Friends. Some of you may know Compassionate Friends. It's the organization throughout the world that gathers parents who have lost children, whatever their age may be. That group we belonged to, and it was a hard group to be a part of because we would be talking about our losses and sharing with one another the encouragement needed. I remember one woman in particular in that group, way up in years, having lost five of her children. And yet she had such a gentle grace about her, such a gentle grace. Well, I was invited on December 9, 2006, on Light One Candle observance to share the border. And I said I would, but I said I also have to share a postscript. And this is the postscript. It's been well over 2 years since I wrote The Unwelcome Border. At the time I wrote the piece, I'd expected one day my unwelcome border would grow tired of our home and move on down the road. But he hasn't. I could give you a long list of complaints I have about my unwelcome border. For example, I find that I must worry about his shifty ways. He has a predilection to steal. He steals what does not belong to him. Of late, I catch him trying to steal from us memories of our Angie. At night, I count the memories like a householder counting silver forks and spoons after a feast, lest some pieces turn up missing. If that were not enough worry, I've caught my unwelcome border's oafish hands toying with our precious heirloom we call hope. The winter of our grief is long, and the hope of spring can be distant. Precious is our hope. So I find myself wrestling from his clumsy hands our heirloom hope, as he carelessly let it fall to the floor and it shatter. I once thought that my unwelcome border would grow tired of us and move on down the road. I now know better. He's here to stay as long as we reside this side of heaven. Moreover, as long as we reside this side of heaven, I will continue to endure his unwelcome habits, and I will count our precious memories of our Angie, and I will hold gently but firmly the hope that God has given us to hold. Of that hope, the prophet Isaiah has spoken. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return home. They shall come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness and sorrow and sighing. Even my unwelcome border shall flee away. Well, that was 2 years or so after Angie's passing. I wrote that. And now it's 13 years, and there is yet another postscript, which I'll share with you. I have come to understand that my unwelcome border, not only did I need to make peace with him, knowing he's going to be around, but I also have come to know I need to make friends with him. Even more than that, in the last couple of years, I would say, come to understand the border is really not someone different than me. It's just a very traumatic kind of experience that one tends to objectify and want to not have a part of oneself. This thing we call grief, that's finally woven into the fabric of our lives. When we lose those we love, that grief woven into our lives, and through the work of God's Holy Spirit, that is woven into our lives in a way that the grief and the joys and the hopes and the love, all of that is woven together. It is who we are. Indeed, it makes us who we are in the eyes of God. And I have this strange kind of paradox. I hope it makes sense as I share it. There are times when I would want Angie back right as it was, life unchanged. And yet there are other moments I realize the loss has made me who I am. And it's like, how do you have it both ways? It's one of those paradoxes. Perhaps some of you who have taken that road will understand what I'm saying. How does the story end? How does the story end? Well, you know how it ends, how Luke writes it. Their eyes are opened, and they say, we've seen the Lord. Our hearts transformed. We got to share that news, but we have seen the Lord. John, in his old age, he says how the story ends. He writes, beloved, we are God's children now. Don't ever forget that. And what we will be has not yet been fully revealed. There, the road to Emmaus continues, you might say. What we will be has not yet been fully revealed, but what we do know is this. When the Lord is revealed to us, we will be like him. For we will see him as he is, and all the communion of saints and our loved ones too. We will see him as he is. We have seen the Lord is how the story ends. And now in the spirit of the Beatitude, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. John adds, and all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Blessed are the pure in heart, those who purified in God's love and comforting Holy Spirit, for they shall see God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.